Hello and welcome to my channel Engineering Made Simple. Now, as you all know, we were studying wireless networks. Now, in wireless networks, today we are going to study lecture number two, that is wireless personal area networks. Now, in wireless personal area networks, we are going to study various technologies. Today, we are going to study Bluetooth technology, which is nothing but IEEE 802.15.1. Now, what is wireless personal area network? A wireless personal area network is a short distance, typically whose coverage radius is less than 10 meter but as far as 20 meter. Wireless network specifically designed to support portable and mobile computing devices such as PCs, personal digital assistants, PDAs, printers and storage devices. Now, a simple example of wireless personal area network in our day-to-day life I would like to give over here. Now suppose thing I have a Wi-Fi router at home which provides me wireless internet connectivity to which I have connected my laptop, my smart television, my smart AC and my Wi-Fi printer. So all these devices are connected together to form a wireless personal area network. So this is nothing but a wireless personal area network. This is what is given in the definition over here. It is a short distance wireless network specifically designed to support portable and mobile computing devices using wireless technology. Now, since it uses wireless technology, now there should be some standards making body who will be able to design or develop protocols according to which these devices will function and will be able to connect to wireless personal area network. So, for these protocols are given by wireless personal area network protocols are given by IEEE 802.15 committee. So, we will study what is that committee in detail. Now, next. Now, Bluetooth IEEE 802.15.1 UWB, IEEE 802.15.3A and ZigBee, IEEE 802.15.4 are examples of wireless personal area network technologies that allow devices within close proximity to join together in wireless network in order to exchange information. Now, as I told you earlier, IEEE 802.15.1 committee is responsible for developing standards for various wireless networks. So this is what I have mentioned here once again. The IEEE 802.15.15 committee has the responsibility for developing standards for short distance wireless networks used in networking of portable and mobile computing devices such as PCs, PDAs, cell phones, etc. Now further, the IEEE 802.15 committee consists of four task groups. That is task group 1, which is IEEE 802.15.1, task group 2, which is also known as coexistence wireless local area network and WPAN, which is nothing but wireless personal area network. Then we come to task group 3, IEEE 802.15.3, high-rate WPAN and IEEE 802.15.3A, that is very high-rate WPAN. Now we will study each of these task groups in detail. Now task group 1, it is for Bluetooth and defines physical and medium access control specifications for wireless connectivity with fixed, portable and moving devices within or entering a personal operating space, POS. A personal operating space is the space around a person or object that typically extends up to 10 meters in all directions and envelops the person whether stationary or in motion. Now, what is task group 2? It focuses on coexistence of wireless personal area network. That is coexistence meaning a wireless personal area network should be able to connect to wireless local area network. So, the goal of the WPAN group is to achieve a level of interoperability that allows data transfer between a wireless personal area network device and an IEEE 802.11, that is WLAN device. So it allows communication between wireless local area network and wireless personal area network. That is nothing but coexistence WLAN and WPAN. That is nothing but task group 2. Now we will move on to task group 3. Now it works on the physical and MAC layers for very high rate WPANs that operate at a data rate more than 20 Mbps and will provide for low power low-cost solutions to address the needs of portable consumers, digital imaging, and multimedia applications. The standards aim at providing compatibility with Bluetooth specifications. Now, fourth and the last task group, as per the IEEE 802.15 committee, is Task Group 4. Now, in Task Group 4, it investigates an ultra-low complexity, ultra-low power-consuming, ultra-low cost physical and MAC layer for data rates up to 200 kbps. The potential applications in Task Group 4 are sensors, interactive toys, smart badges, remote controls, and home automation. Now next, we will move on to study our main technology, wireless personal area network. Main technology for the day, which is IEEE 802.15.1, which is Bluetooth technology. Now, the Bluetooth technology or wireless networking standard was developed by Swedish telecommunication company Ericsson. It was named after King of Denmark, Harald I Bluetooth, hence the name Bluetooth. So, Bluetooth provides short-range communication, that is coverage radius of this wireless personal area network technology, that is Bluetooth, is less than 10 meters. And low-cost communication devices, that is less than 10 USD per device. And bandwidth which the Bluetooth technology provides is about 780 kbps. Now, Bluetooth radio characteristics include low power, that is why it is ideal for PDAs and mobile phones, short range and medium transmission speed, which is up to 780 kbps. Now, Bluetooth allows a wide range of communication devices to connect with each other and transfer data wirelessly. Now, this we know as we use Bluetooth in our day-to-day life. Suppose I want to transfer images from my old phone to my new phone. I can simply turn on the Bluetooth on both the phones and transfer those images very easily. So that is what is written over here. Bluetooth allows wide range of communication devices to connect with each other and transfer data wirelessly. Now next, the Bluetooth system operates in the 2.4 GHz industrial scientific medicine band. Now this ISM band is that part of the electromagnetic spectrum which is unlicensed band. That is, the user need not pay anything to the service provider to use this band as it is unlicensed. So, because it is useful for industrial, scientific, and medicine and research purposes. So, the Bluetooth system operates all over the world in the 2.4 GHz unlicensed industrial, scientific, and medicine band. That's the reason, as this band is, ISM band is unlicensed, that's the reason we did not pay anything to use Bluetooth technology. Now, in many countries, the industrial, scientific, and medicine band frequency band ranges from 2.4 GHz to 2.4835 GHz. So, now let us study the radio specifications of Bluetooth. Now, the radio specifications of IEEE 802.5.1 Bluetooth are listed in the following table. First is the frequency band. Now, as I had mentioned earlier, Bluetooth technology operates in the industrial, scientific, and medicine band, which is in the range of 2.4 GHz to 2.4835 GHz in most of the countries. So, first thing, when you study radio specifications of any wireless technology in particular, you will study the frequency band or frequency range it occupies. So for USA, it is 2.4 GHz to 2.4835 GHz. That is, within this bandwidth, Bluetooth has 17 radio frequency channels, that is 79 RF channels. In Spain, the Bluetooth technology occupies the frequency band of 2.445 to 2.475 GHz, and in which the Bluetooth technology gets 23 RF channels. Now in France, Bluetooth technology uses 2.4465 to 2.4835 GHz frequency band, which accommodates 23 radio frequency channels. Now, as we discussed earlier, what are the frequency bands and how many channels are found within those frequency bands? We will study what is the bandwidth of each RF channel in Bluetooth radio specifications. That is nothing but bandwidth of a single RF channel is 1 MHz. Means if there are 79 RF channels as per US and Europe and most of the other countries, bandwidth of one out of these 79 RF channels will be 1 MHz. That is 79 RF channels will be there with bandwidth of 1 MHz each. So bandwidth of each RF channel is 1 MHz. Gross data rate is 1 Mbps initial and 2 Mbps for the latter. Time slot duration is 626 microseconds. Time division multiplexing is used to divide the channel into time slots. Now one-to-one connection allowable maximum signal data rate. Maximum data rate will be 721 kbps and there will be 3 voice channels available for voice communication. Now what is the signal modulation scheme used in Bluetooth? That is Gaussian frequency shift keying, that is GFSK. Now multiple access scheme when in a piconet. Now what is a piconet scatter net, you will come to know when we will study the further part of the topic, which is Bluetooth. But what is the multiple access technique used in while accessing Bluetooth piconet is frequency hopping, time division duplexing, time division multiple access. And how does a wireless personal area network in Bluetooth, which is a scatter net, which multiple access technique which it will use? That is nothing but frequency hopping, code division multiple access. Now frequency hopping meaning how many times the frequency changes. Now frequency hopping rate is the next parameter. So hop meaning what is the meaning of hop? Hop means simple frequency changes or a change. So how many times the frequency changes? The frequency changes by in any Bluetooth technology or Bluetooth device, frequency changes by 1600 hops per second. And what is the range of Bluetooth technology or wireless personal area network to be connected or coverage area of Bluetooth technology? The range is nothing but range or the coverage radius of WPAN connected using Bluetooth technology is nothing but 10 meters. Now next. Now we'll study some of the important terminologies related to Bluetooth technology. Now. First term we will study is piconet. Collection of devices connected using Bluetooth. They can be minimum 2 and maximum they can grow up to 8 connected devices. All connected devices, that is peers, have identical implementation except one device which will act as master while establishing a piconet for synchronization purposes. Now what does it mean? Now if you want to connect or configure a wireless personal area network using Bluetooth technology, minimum two Bluetooth devices should be there for connection. Maximum there can be 8, they can grow up to 8 connected devices. Now if there are 8 connected devices, one device will act as a master and other devices will by default act as a slave. So the slave has to be synchronized with the master. So master provides the synchronization hopping sequence to all the slaves. So for time being, remember that if there are 8 devices connected, one of them will be master and that master will use some hopping frequency which will be used for establishing a piconet and other 7 will be treated as slaves. So Bluetooth, one thing is to be remembered that one is a master and other connected devices are slaves. So it works in master slave fashion. Now next, scatternet. Now two or more independent non-synchronized piconets that can communicate with each other. A slave as well as a master unit in one piconet can establish this connection by becoming a slave in another piconet. Now if there are two piconets which are unsynchronized and independent to each other, meaning I have a Bluetooth network 1, I have a Bluetooth network 2. This is a Bluetooth piconet which is synchronized with its master consisting of 4 devices. This is another Bluetooth network consisting of four devices, which is also synchronized with that network's master, but a slave can communicate with the master of another piconet also. So a slave as well as master unit in one piconet can establish this connection by becoming a slave in another piconet. So if in network one this particular device or some particular device master, then in another piconet while communicating with the other piconet it can behave as a slave. So that is nothing but scatternet. So two or more independent and non-synchronous piconets that communicate with each other are known as scatternets. So I repeat this point one more time. A slave as well as master unit in one piconet can establish this connection by becoming a slave in another piconet. So this is nothing but scatternet. Now, what is a master unit? The device in the piconet whose clock and hopping sequence are used to synchronize all the other devices in the piconet. So this I had explained to you earlier when we were discussing piconet. So what is a master unit? The device in the piconet whose clock and hopping sequence are used to synchronize all the other devices in the piconet. Now next, slave units. All the devices in the piconet that are not master, up to 7 active units for each master. So the devices in the piconet which are not masters are all as slaves, that they are known as slave units. Now the next term, media access control address or MAC address. A 3-bit medium access control address used to distinguish between units participate in the piconet. So from the MAC address one can know MAC address is a physical address which can be used to distinguish between different devices, and from that only we will come to know if a particular data is intended for that device or not. So that is a medium access control address. So it is 3-bit medium access control address used to distinguish between units participating in the piconet. So by knowing the MAC address, we can MAC address the devices, different device connected devices can be distinguished with each other as it is a physical address. MAC address is a physical address. So all the 3 Bluetooth devices will have different medium access control addresses. Now next, part units. Devices in a piconet which are time synchronized but do not have MAC addresses. So if if they don't have any medium access control addresses but are time synchronized with the master, they are known as part units, or they are simply in the low power states. So if they don't have any MAC addresses assigned to them. Devices that are now what is sniff and hold mode. Devices that are synchronized to piconet and which have temporarily entered power saving mode in which device activity is reduced. So this is pretty much clear. Now if they are in a low power state, they are said to be, if Bluetooth devices are in a low power state, they are said to be in sniff and hold mode. So park units are the one who are time synchronized but do not have MAC address. So these were few of the important terms related to Bluetooth. Now we will briefly discuss the protocol stack of Bluetooth. So this is how the Bluetooth protocol stack looks like. So here we have host controller interface, Bluetooth radio, baseband protocols, some link manager protocols, and L2 cap layer, RF comm, and all these other protocols which are used in Bluetooth. So we will study each of the following in detail. Now, why do we need to study a protocol stack? Whenever you study any wireless technology or any wired communication technology also, we need to understand how the technology functions from a technical point of view. To understand it, we need to study the protocol stack in order to develop the understanding that how these devices communicate, which devices are compatible with those devices. So likewise, we study many protocol stacks in our computer communication networks course as well. So the protocol stack or Bluetooth protocol stack does also serves the same purpose. The Bluetooth protocol stack allows devices to locate, connect, and exchange data with each other and to execute interoperable interactive applications with each other. Now the Bluetooth protocol stack is divided into three groups. And those three groups are as follows. First one is the transport protocol group. Second one is the middleware protocol group. Third one is the application group. Now we will study transport protocol group in the Bluetooth protocol stack in detail. Now the protocols in this group are designed to allow Bluetooth devices to locate and connect to each other. So this protocol group is nothing but it is designed in such a way that it allows contains certain protocols that allow Bluetooth devices to locate each other and connect with each other. Now next, the protocols in this group are radio, baseband, logic link control and adaptation protocol, that is L2CAP layer, and host control and interface. Now this we had seen in the diagram earlier. Now we will discuss each of these following in detail. As of now, I have only listed the protocols in the transport protocol group. Now we will discuss what does the transport protocol do and what each of these protocols given in the red link, namely L2CAP layer or host control interface, in detail. So what does the transport protocol group do? The protocol in this group are designed to allow Bluetooth devices to locate and connect with each other. These protocols, that is in the transport protocol group, carry audio and data traffic between devices and support both synchronous and asynchronous transmission for telephony grade voice communication. Audio traffic is treated with high priority in Bluetooth. Audio traffic bypasses all the protocol layers and goes directly to the baseband layer, which then transmits it in small packets over Bluetooth's air interface. Now the protocols in this transport protocol group are also responsible for managing physical and logical link between the devices, so that the layers above and application can pass data through these connections. Now the protocols in this group are radio baseband, link manager, logical link, and host control and interfaces. Now we will study these protocols in detail. First protocol we will study is logical link control and adaptation protocol, that is L2CAP layer. So all data traffic is routed through logical link control and adaptation protocol layer. The layer shields the higher layers from the details of the lower layers. The higher layers need not be aware of the frequency hops occurring at the radio and baseband layer. It is also responsible for segmenting larger packets from higher layers into smaller packets, which are easier to handle by the lower layer. The L2CAP layer in the 2PL devices facilitates the maintenance of the desired grade of service. The L2CAP layer is responsible for admission of control based on the requested level of service and for coordinating with the lower layers to maintain this level of service. So this was about logical link control and adaptation protocol. The next protocol we will study is link manager layer. The link manager layers in communicating devices are responsible for negotiating the properties of the Bluetooth air interface between them. The properties may be anything from bandwidth allocation to support services of a particular type of periodic bandwidth reservation for audio traffic. The layer is responsible for supervising device pairing. Device pairing is creation of a trust relationship between devices by generating and storing an authentication key for future device authentication. Now this thing we know. Whenever a Bluetooth device is connect to a new device for the first time, first thing we have to do is pairing. So pairing procedure is looked after by this layer, that is the link manager layer. So which is technically known as authentication. So this is an important step in establishing a communication between two Bluetooth devices. If this fails, or if the pairing procedure or authentication procedure in more technical terms fails, the communication link may get severed. The link managers are also responsible for power control and may request adjustment in power levels of Bluetooth devices. Now the next functions we will study of the baseband and radio layers. The baseband layer is responsible for the process of searching for other devices and establishing a connection between them. So it is also responsible for assigning the master and slave roles. This layer also controls the Bluetooth unit synchronization and transmission frequency hopping sequence. This layer also manages the link between devices and is responsible for determining the packet types supported for synchronous and asynchronous traffic. Now the next layer is the host controller interface layer, HCI layer. The HCI layer allows higher layers of the stack, including applications, to access the baseband, link manager, etc. through a single interface. Through HCI commands, the module may enter certain modes of operation. Higher layers are informed of certain events through the HCI. The HCI is not a required part of the specification. It has been developed to serve the purpose of interoperability between host devices and Bluetooth modules. Bluetooth product implementation need not be HCI compliant to support a fully compliant Bluetooth air interface. So when I say Bluetooth air interface, I am referring to Bluetooth radio specifications. Now next, now one important thing to note here is that all these protocols I had explained to you in detail. So you are supposed to explain those in detail in the exam. So here in this presentation, I have only listed them, but you have to discuss each and every protocol in detail, namely radio, baseband, logical link controller and adaptation, and host controller interface. Now next we move on to middleware protocol. So middleware protocol group. So this group comprises the protocols needed for existing applications to operate over the Bluetooth links. So this group consists some of the protocols needed for applications to operate over the Bluetooth links. So the protocols in the links can be third party and industry standard protocols, and the protocols developed specifically by special interest group for Bluetooth wireless communication. Now the protocols in this group are, group can include TCP, that is Transmission Control Protocol, IP, that is Internet Protocol, and peer-to-peer protocol. A serial port emulator, RFCOM, that enables applications that normally would interface with a serial port to operate with Bluetooth things. So it also consists of RFCOM protocols. Now similarly, we move again forward. The group also has a service discovery protocol, which lets devices discover each other's services. In addition to service discovery protocol, this middleware protocol group consists of infrared data association interoperability protocols, object exchange protocol, networking layers and telephone control specification layer and audio. So what are these layers? We will study in detail. Now first layer or protocol we will study is RFCOM layer. Now what is RFCOM layer? Serial ports are the most common communication interface we use today. These serial ports invariably involve the use of cable. Now, RFCOM provides a virtual serial port. Now, as you know, serial port involves with the use of cables, but here we are dealing with wireless personal area network. So, what does the Bluetooth technology do is that it creates a virtual serial port using RFCOM protocol. That is what is given over here. So, RFCOM provides a virtual serial port to applications. The advantage provided by this layer is that it is easy for applications designed for cable serial ports to migrate to Bluetooth using the RFCOM layer. So RFCOM is an important part of the protocol because of the function it performs. Now service discovery protocol. Now the service discovery protocol layer. Now in Bluetooth wireless communication, any two devices can start communicating at any time. Once the connection is established, there is need to find and understand each other's services and what services the other device has to offer.
This is taken care of by the service discovery protocol, as I had mentioned earlier, by this layer. So the service discovery protocol is a standard method for Bluetooth devices to discover and learn about the services offered by other devices. Service discovery is important in providing value to the end user. Now another thing we will study is that the infrared data association and interoperability protocols. The SIG has adopted some interoperability protocols to ensure interoperability between applications. So IoT and Bluetooth share some of the important attributes. The infrared object exchange protocol, that is OBEX, is designed to enable units supporting infrared communication to exchange wide range of data and comments using the Bluetooth technology. The last but not the least, OBEX protocol. OBEX protocol, in short, is infrared object exchange protocol, is a session protocol developed by Infrared Data Association to exchange objects in a simple and spontaneous manner. OBEX provides the same basic functionality as the HTTP. So, in addition, the OBEX protocol also defines the folder listing object, which can be used to browse the contents of a folder in a remote device. So, if a device is connected via Bluetooth technology, you can access the folders on the connected device using that OBEX protocol. Many of the times, it is also visible on your mobile devices also. So, transfer files using OBEX protocol when you connect to Bluetooth. Now, the next layers are in the middleware protocol group. The next layer is networking layers. Now, Bluetooth wireless communication uses a peer-to-peer network topology rather than a LAN topology. Now, for that, dial-up networking uses the attention command layer. So, in most cases, the network that is being accessed is an IP network, that is, a network that uses internet protocol. Now, once a dial-up connection is established to an IP network, then the standard protocols like transmission control protocol, user datagram protocol and hypertext transfer protocol can be used. A device can also connect to an IP network using a network access point. Now the internet peer-to-peer protocol is used to connect to the access point. Now the specification does not define a profile that uses TCP/IP or Bluetooth links. So directly it doesn't explain us, however, how this communication takes place, but it derives all these properties from the TCP/IP protocols point peer-to-peer protocols. Now last but not the least protocol, or the layer to be more precise, in the middleware protocol group is the telephone control specification, that is TCS and audio. The layer is designed to support telephony functions that include call control and group management using Bluetooth technology. These are associated with setting up of voice calls. When a call is established, a Bluetooth audio channel can carry the call's voice content. Now the telephone control specification can be also used to set up data calls. So this is the function of the telephone control specification layer and audio. Now the third group Bluetooth protocol stack, third and the last one actually, is the application group. Now the group that consists of actual applications that make use of Bluetooth links or Bluetooth technology and refers to the software that exists above the protocol stack. So this is very similar to your application layer of your OSI model. So the software uses the protocol stack to provide some function to the user of Bluetooth devices. So the Bluetooth special interest group does not define any application layer protocols. So specific application layer protocols are not defined by the special interest group of Bluetooth, nor does it specify any API, that is application programmer interface. So but main thing it does, that it provides support to applications that makes use of Bluetooth technology that exists, there are application software that exists above the protocol stack. So now after studying the Bluetooth protocol stack, we will study the different link types in Bluetooth. So let us discuss Bluetooth link types.
So
Now let us study the state model of Bluetooth. In other words, it is also known as state model of Bluetooth or network connection establishment in Bluetooth. Now the state diagram is in front of your eyes. Now what is a state diagram? State diagram will help you to understand the different states of a device and how the device changes its state from one state to another state due to the application of some external input. So now we were studying Bluetooth technology. So this is the state diagram of Bluetooth technology. All the devices that are using Bluetooth technology. Now before any connection is in a piconet is created, all the devices that is Bluetooth devices are in the standby mode. Now in this mode, an unconnected unit periodically listens for messages for every 1.28 seconds. Every time a device wakes up, it listens on a set of 32 hop frequencies. Now when initially the device, when all the devices in the piconet, before any connection in the piconet is created, all the devices are in standby mode. Standby mode is similar to our sleep mode. So whenever the device wakes up from the standby mode, it listens periodically for messages for every 1.28 seconds. So each time a device wakes up, it listens on a set of 32 hop frequencies defined for that unit. The number of hop frequencies varies in different geographical regions. Now, firstly, when I said by default all the devices are in standby mode. But when your connection, when you are supposed to initiate a connection, so the connection procedure has to be initiated by one of these devices which are participating in a piconet. So when the device which sends in the connection request initially becomes a master and all the other device becomes a slave. So connection is made by page message if the address of the device is already known, or by an inquiry message followed by subsequent page message if an address is unknown. So now in the initial page state, the master unit sends a train of 16 identical page messages on 16 different hop frequencies defined for the device to be paged, that is the slave unit. So it is simple. First thing is first that master sends 16 identical page messages on 16 different hop frequencies to the different slaves. Now if no response is received from the slave, the master again transmits a train of remaining 16 hop frequencies in the wake of sequence. Now, we will discuss the enquiry state in detail. Now, what is enquiry? The enquiry message is typically used for finding Bluetooth devices including public printers, fax machines and similar devices with an unknown address. So, as we discussed earlier, if you don't know the address of the device to be pulled, an enquiry message is sent along with a page message. So, the enquiry message is similar to the page message but may require one additional train period to collect all the responses from the data. Also, there are three states in the power saving mode as well. So, a power saving mode can be used for connected units in a piconet if no data needs to be transmitted. So, power saving needs to be enabled if there is no data to transmit when all the devices are in a connected state. So, the master unit can put the slave units into hold mode where only the internal timer is running. Slave units can also demand to be put into hold mode. So master can also put the device into the hold mode, whereas slaves can also demand to the master that I want to go into the hold mode. So data transfer restarts instantly when units transition out of the hold mode. When the hold mode period ends, the retransmission restarts instantly from where it stopped earlier. So, the hold mode is used when connecting several piconets or managing a low power device such as temperature sensor. So, here I have discussed one utility of the hold mode. That is, the hold mode is used when several piconets are communicating with each other with a low power device such as temperature sensor. In such cases, slaves may require to go into the hold mode or low power state. So, two more low power modes are also available. You can see in the diagram that they are hold and sniff modes. Sorry, they are sniff and park modes. Now in a sniff mode, a slave device listens to the picolet at a reduced duty cycle. The sniff interval is programmable and depends on the application in which we are using the Bluetooth picolet. Now in the park mode, a device is still synchronized to the picolet but does not participate in the traffic that is transmitting data. Park devices have given up the MAC addresses and will occasionally listen to the traffic and of the master, and they will have to resynchronize themselves to the picolet hop sequence on the basis and if they want to transmit anything again. So park devices are those devices which have given out their MAC addresses, so they need to again resynchronize to the picolet again once they want to participate in transmission or reception or vice versa. So, and it periodically, the device in sniff mode will also check periodically for some broadcast messages. So, this is nothing but your state model of Bluetooth technology, or it is also known as network connection establishment in Bluetooth. So
now, after studying the Bluetooth protocol stack, we will study the different link types in Bluetooth. So let us discuss Bluetooth link types. So the Bluetooth baseband technology supports two link types. First one is synchronous connection oriented type, used for voice communications using Bluetooth technology. Second one is asynchronous connection oriented type, that is SCL, used for packet data communications using Bluetooth technology. Now, both the link types use time division duplexing scheme for a full duplex transmission. Now, what do you understand by full duplex transmission? Transmission of data and reception of data can take place simultaneously. Now, what is this time division duplexing? Time division duplexing is nothing but both the uplink and downlink channels are given different time slots by dividing the time slots. So it is known as time division duplexing, which is used for full duplex transmission in both these type of links, that is SCO link, that is synchronous connection oriented type, and asynchronous connection less type, which is used for packet data. Now we will study the properties, each of these two types in detail. So synchronous connection oriented type, SCO link, which is used for voice communications. The SCO link is symmetric. Symmetric link meaning bandwidth allocated to both the uplink and downlink communication are the same. So bandwidth is the same for uplink and downlink. So it is known as symmetric link. So SCO packets are transmitted over reserved intervals, that is time slots. So once the connection is established, as it is a connection oriented type, before any data transfer takes place, connection needs to be established. So once a connection is established, both master and slave units may send synchronous connection oriented packets without being polled. So without any polling function, we can send SCO packets once a connection is established using a synchronous connection oriented type link in Bluetooth. Now, the SCO link type supports circuit switch point to point connection, and it is often used for voice traffic. So that I mentioned to you earlier. Now we move to the next. Oh, sorry. The last and not the least point, the data rate provided by the synchronous connection oriented type of links in Bluetooth is 64 kbps. So now we study the second type of Bluetooth link, which is the asynchronous connectionless type of link, or SCL type of link. This link is used for packet data transfer using Bluetooth technology. Now this is what is the meaning of connectionless type of link? In this type of link, a connection is not set up before transmission. So while transmission only, the packets are routed to the destination, and there is no fixed path or dedicated path between source to destination before the transmission takes place. So this is known as asynchronous connectionless type link, which is used for packet data. Now what are its features? The ACL link is a packet oriented, that means it supports the transfer of data or information in the form of packets, and supports both symmetric and asymmetric traffic. Now, what is the meaning of symmetric and asymmetric traffic? Symmetric traffic meaning both the uplink and downlink have the same bandwidth. That means both the uplink and downlink transmits with the same data rate. And whereas in the asymmetric traffic case, uplink has lower bandwidth than the downlink, or uplink and downlink have simply different bandwidths. So if the uplink and the downlink have different bandwidths, that is they have different data rates of transmission in either direction, so that is known as asymmetric traffic. And in symmetric traffic, the bandwidth allocated for both uplink and downlink is the same. Now next. Now, the master unit controls the link bandwidth in the SCL and decides how much picowidth bandwidth is given to each cell and the symmetry of traffic. So this statement is very much clear that the master unit, when it uses the synchronous connectionless type of link, controls the bandwidth of the piconet and how much bandwidth should be given to each slave and what should be the symmetry of traffic, whether it should be asymmetric or symmetric, that is also decided by the master in that piconet. Now, slaves must be polled before they can transmit data. Now, what is the meaning of polling? The master will ask the slave whether you have some data to send. So, polling is nothing but a simple question from the master to the slave. Tell me whether you have something to send. And then accordingly, the slaves can transmit data only after the polling after it is being polled by the master. So the ACL link also supports broadcast messages from all the master to all the slaves in the piconet. This is very much clear. So multi-slot packets can be used in ACL type of link and can reach maximum data rates of 721 kbps. So from this we come to know that multi-slot packets are your normal and they support asymmetric type of traffic because the data rates in both the directions are different. So it supports maximum data rate of 721 kbps in one direction and 57.6 kbps in other direction if no error correction is used. So one more important thing to note here is that in Bluetooth technology there are different types of packets available. So then there are different type of packets available. So you need to study that also in detail. I am not discussing that you will get in the Vijay Garg book. Recommended reading book number 1, that is Vijay Garg, Wireless Communication and Networking. So now this we will move on to discuss the Bluetooth security architecture. Now this is how our Bluetooth security architecture looks like, and these are the various entities or components or elements we can say, or interfaces or layers we can say, that are part of your Bluetooth security architecture. Now as you can see, there is one user interface. There is an application layer, there is an RFCOM layer. RFCOM, what is RFCOM? We had discussed while we were discussing Bluetooth protocol stack. L2CAP also we have discussed at the same time. And HCI, which stands for host controller interface, link manager and link controller. It also consists of service database and device database. It also contains some of the general management entities which performs some certain management functions. And the most important part of the Bluetooth security architecture, that is the security manager, that it manages the security of the Bluetooth link. So, and here one more important thing to note here is that here all the black colored arrows denote a query, whereas the green orange color arrow denotes registration. So now we will study what is the Bluetooth security architecture in detail. So now let us study the Bluetooth security architecture. We have already seen its diagram. Now Bluetooth security architecture supports authentication and encryption. Now these two processes are done with the help of key that is shared by devices. A pairing procedure is used when two devices communicate for the first time, generate this key. Now what does this statement mean? This statement we have observed in our day-to-day life when you use Bluetooth technology. Suppose thing I connect my old smartphone to new smartphone to transfer some of my images from my old phone, and obviously in my new smartphone my old smartphone will not be paired. So first it will initiate a pairing procedure. It will ask whether you want to pair with this device, and after that it will generate a key, and then it will ask whether this key matches with the key that we have provided on another device. So that is nothing but pairing procedure, which is done with the help of passkey. And this procedure only happens when we are communicating with the device for the first time. So pairing happens only once when we are communicating with any new device. So that is what is given over here. This is done with the help of link key that is shared by devices. A pairing procedure is used when two devices communicate for the first time to generate this key. Now there are three security modes to Bluetooth devices. Now we will discuss those. Non-secure, a device will not initiate any security procedure. So that is the most not secure mode of data transfer in any Bluetooth device. Second mode is service level enforced security. A device does not initiate security procedures before channel establishment at L2 cap level. This mode allows different and flexible access policies in application, especially running applications with different security requirements in parallel. So that is very much clear from the diagram which I had shown below, which consisted of the L2 cap layer beneath the three application layers, and the three applications are running in parallel. So that is nothing but service level enforced security. Now the third type of device security mode is link level enforced security. A device initiates security procedures before the link is set up at the LMP is completed. Before the link setup at the LMP is completed. So before setting up of link, the security procedure is initiated. So this is what is nothing but is called as link level enforced security. So now as we have studied the Bluetooth security architecture, we move on to study the different type of security levels in Bluetooth. Now there are two kinds of security levels in Bluetooth technology, namely authentication and authorization. So we will briefly discuss the first one. This is the diagram for the authentication procedure in Bluetooth technology. Now what do you mean by authentication? Authentication procedure verifies who is at the other end of the link. Now in Bluetooth, this is achieved by the authentication procedure based on the stored link key or pairing key used while pairing procedure. So as you know, a link key is generated when two Bluetooth devices are paired for the first time or communicate for the first time. So let us discuss the authentication procedure and its steps in detail. The first step in authentication is the host controller interface sends a connect request to the L2 cap layer. Now the L2 cap layer requests access from the security manager, as you can see in the figure over here. The security manager then inquires the service database. So what are the different types of services available so that I can give the access to the requesting service. Now the security manager in the next step or the fourth step again inquires the device database for its services or what are the applications that particular Bluetooth device consists of. So that is nothing but it inquires to the device database. After inquiring with the service database and device database, the security manager again, if necessary, enforces the authentication and encryption procedure and informs accordingly to the host controller interface. As you can see, the communication between host control and interface and security manager is bidirectional. Now in the sixth step, the security manager grants the connection request to the requesting service and the L2 cap layer setups the link for the further communication. So this is how authentication takes place. And last but not the least step, when the access is granted and link is set up, the service provides the designated service to the application layer, which is present on the top. So the L2 cap layer, on getting the access and after setting up of link from the security manager, it provides various services to the application. So this is what is your authentication procedure. Now we move on to the study the second type of Bluetooth security level, which is authorization procedure. Now in authorization, what is authorization? When a device accesses another device, it is trusting the device with its data. What this means is simply that when I allow other device to access the content on my device, I am simply trusting that device with my data. That is, I am trusting that device by giving access to my data on my device. So that is nothing but known as it is trusting the device with its data. Now, trusted devices are allowed to access the services, whereas untrusted devices require authorization based on user interaction. So this is pretty much clear. Now, there are three types of devices. Trusted device, a device with fixed relationship pair, that is paired device that has trusted and unrestricted access to all services on another device to which it is paired and listed as trusted device. Second device is untrusted device. This device has been previously authenticated and a link is stored, but the device is not marked as trusted device in the device database. So what is the device database? We have studied in the Bluetooth security levels diagram. That is, this is a device which is not marked as trusted, but pairing or authentication procedure has been taken place previously. That is, pairing procedure has been taken place and a link key is stored, but it is not marked as trusted device. So that is known as an untrusted device. Third is, an unknown device is an untrusted device to which no security information is available for this device in the device database. So that is an unknown device. So when we communicate, whenever the Bluetooth radio scans for the any new devices, it first says that it is unknown device. That is, it does not know any of its properties, nor does it know its system name. Only after pairing procedure, the device can fall in the other two categories, namely trusted device and untrusted device. So an unknown device is an untrusted device. No security information is available for this device in the device database of the security architecture of Bluetooth. Now, for services, the requirement of authentication, authorization, and encryption are set independently. The access requirement defines these three security levels. Services that require authentication and authorization. Automatic access is only granted to trusted devices. Other devices need to perform a manual authorization procedure. Services that require authentication only. So, there are few services that require authentication only and no authorization is necessary. So that is what is mentioned over here, that services that require authentication only, in such cases authorization is not necessary. Now next, services open to all devices. So where authentication, no access required, approval or authorization is required before service access is granted. So the default policy will be used unless other settings are found in the security database related to the service. Now all these three things we are talking about the service database, which I had shown to you earlier when we were discussing the Bluetooth security architecture also and the authentication procedure also. So if the settings and other services are not available with the service database, the default policy will be used to provide services. So before studying the Bluetooth packet format, we will first learn about the limitations of the Bluetooth security model or Bluetooth security architecture. Now as per the Bluetooth security architecture, one can only authenticate the Bluetooth device, not its user. So that is the main limitation of the Bluetooth security model. Now we move on to study Bluetooth packet format. The Bluetooth packet format is, so as per the Bluetooth packet format, in every Bluetooth packet, 72 bits are allocated to access code, out of which 4 bits are reserved for preamble, 64 bits are reserved for synchronization purposes out of the 72 bits allocated to access code, and 4 bits are allocated for the trailer. So this is how the access code is divided into. It consists of 4 preamble bits, 64 synchronization bits, and 4 bits are allocated to the trailer. And the header of the Bluetooth packet consists of 54 bits, and the payload consists, that is the data payload or user data consists of 2745 bits in the Bluetooth packet. So this is mainly the packet structure used, which is transferred in the Bluetooth technology. Each and every packet that is transferred via Bluetooth technology will have this format. So that is a fixed format. We can't change the number of bits allocated to access code, number of bits allocated to the packet header, and so on. So we can say the Bluetooth packet format has a fixed format. So each packet in Bluetooth begins with a 72-bit access code that is derived from the master in that network, and it is unique for each channel. Every packet exchanged on the channel is preceded by this access code. Recipients on the Piconet compare the incoming signals with the access code. If the access code does not match, then the received packet is discarded as it is not the intended recipient. So if the two do not match, the received packet is not considered valid on the channel and the rest of its contents are ignored. Besides packet identification, the access code is also used for synchronization purposes. So it is pretty much clear from the diagram that the access code consists of 64 bits which which are used for synchronization purposes. So the access code is also resistant and robust towards interference. So owing to this type of packet format in Bluetooth, two or several piconets can communicate with each other and form a scatter net. Now let us study different type of error correction mechanisms available with Bluetooth technology. Now there are three error correction schemes in Bluetooth. First one is one by three rate forward error correction, that is FEC code, 2 by 3 rate forward error correction code, and automatic repeat request scheme for acknowledgement of the data, or automatic request scheme for the data transmission. So that we can say it is a three-layer error correction mechanism is performed in Bluetooth technology. Now the purpose of using forward error correction scheme on the data payload, which is of 2745 bits as per the Bluetooth packet format, is to reduce the number of retransmission and errors. So if errors are less, the number of retransmissions are also less. So the packet header is always protected by 1 by 3 rate FEC. It contains link information and it is used to survive, or it is used to correct the bit errors. So for bit error correction in the packet header, 1 by 3 rate FEC is used. An unnumbered ARQ scheme is applied in which data is transmitted in one slot and it is directly acknowledged by the recipient in the next slot. So for a data transmission to be acknowledgement or positively acknowledged, that it is that positive acknowledgement meaning the sender which has sent the data to the receiver is error free. So for that positive acknowledgement to be heard, both the header, packet header error check, that is 1 by 3 rate FEC and 2 by 3 rate FEC should be satisfied in order to get a positive acknowledgement. Otherwise, a negative acknowledgement is returned. And what is the meaning of negative acknowledgement is that the packet or the data packet which is sent from one device in a Piconet to the other device consists some error. So if you want error-free transmission, both the header check and the cyclic redundancy check must be satisfied. So if it isn't satisfied, a negative acknowledgement is returned. Now let us study the network topology in Bluetooth. Now what is the meaning of network topology? Network topology gives us the geometric representation of how different nodes in the communication network are connected with each other and what are the elements of the network or nodes of the network and how they are connected to one another. Now what is the meaning of network topology in Bluetooth? Simply it means that how are the different type of Bluetooth networks created and how they are connected with one another. So this is what is nothing but known as what is network topology in Bluetooth. So what is network topology in Bluetooth, or what is the structure of the network in Bluetooth? Bluetooth devices can create both point to point and point to multipoint connections, that is one to one communication and broadcast connections also. Now a connection with minimum two devices, Bluetooth device, and maximum eight devices is a Piconet, where all devices follow the same frequency hop sequence or scheme. To avoid interference between devices, one of the devices automatically becomes the master of the Piconet. So to avoid interference between the devices, one of the devices becomes the master And ultimately, when one device becomes the master, other device behaves as slaves. So a Bluetooth topology is nothing but a simple master-slave configuration. So in each slot, a packet is exchanged between the master and one of the slaves. So two or several piconets can communicate with each other and then are called as a scatternet. So this is a basic Bluetooth network topology in Bluetooth, whereas minimum two Bluetooth devices can form a Bluetooth network, and it can go up to maximum eight devices to form a topology or network in Bluetooth. And if in any Bluetooth network, suppose think there are two devices, in a Bluetooth network there are two devices, and one is the master and another is slave. And suppose think in a case of seven Bluetooth devices connected together to form a network, one of them is a master and other devices are slave. So this is the basic network topology in Bluetooth. Now let us study what are the applications of Bluetooth technology. Now this is pretty simple part. Firstly, the Bluetooth provides us with the advantage of replacing serial cables with radio links. That is, it is a wireless technology and data can be transferred wirelessly using Bluetooth technology without the use of USB cables. Second, Bluetooth is a very important feature of various contact tracing apps for COVID-19. Namely, the Arogya Setu app, we require the Bluetooth radio to be turned on to be able to scan and search which are the COVID patients in your nearby vicinity. So the Bluetooth plays a very important role in contact tracing. Second, it is used in wearable networks or WPANs. Secondly, in our normal day-to-day life also, it is used in wireless networking or desktop or room wireless networking. Then the next application is hotspot wireless networking. Secondly, it is used in medical fields for transfer of measured values from training units to analytical system, patient monitoring systems. So a Bluetooth network can be created in a hospital for patient monitoring purposes, as well as to transmit data from some raw data from some training units for analyzing the data, medical data which is available. In automotive industry, remote control of audio video equipment, hands-free telephony. Now everybody has that Bluetooth headphone, so it provides us with the advantage of hands-free telephony. So point of sale payments, Bluetooth technology can be also used by payments by mobile phone, to do payments by mobile phone. So the textbooks or reference books are recommended reading or course material for this course or topic can be found in the following books. Wireless Communication and Networking by Vijay Kegar. You will find mostly all of the content related to Bluetooth in this book only, Wireless Communication and Networking by Vijay Kegar. And the second book is Wireless and Mobile Networks, Networks Concepts and Protocol by Dr. Sushil Kumar S. Manvi, Mahabaleshwar S. Kakasegri. But I would like to recommend the first one, which is the Wireless Communication and Networking by Vijay Kegar for Bluetooth topic at least.